Father, this morning, we're just humbled to be in your presence. Father, I just desire your Holy Spirit to dwell within this place now, and we just ask that you would be with our fellowship, ask that you'd be with our pastor and the word that he's going to give to us today. And as we gather together after the service and just have some fun with a meal and some fellowship, Lord, I just pray that you would bless that time also and use it to your honor and glory. So, Father, today we commit this time to you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Those of you that have a desire to know, just check your bulletin for announcements. We do have a leadership team meeting this week at Tuesday night, every meeting. So if you're part of that team, please come. And if not, please pray for us. We are really desiring your prayer and God's vision and wisdom and all that we do as we go forward. Also, if anyone has any prayer concerns, Pastor's got some cards here. He's got a couple ready, but fill them out, and a little later we'll have time for prayer. So we'll step forward. With that, let's start with the call to worship. And we're in Psalms 119 today, and if we could stand and read that together, that would be great. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. I gain understanding from your precepts. Therefore, I hate every wrong path. The word is a lamp for my feet, a light on my path.
I am, the greater I am. immortal, invisible, God only wise. Like to read Psalm 119, verses 9 through 16, the New International Version. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word.
Beauty see.
definition of that is. And one of the definitions is possessing or sharing in common. This past week, on Wednesday night, Nancy and I went into Mankato to a funeral visitation for a neighbor of ours that lived on our road where we lived, a Native American, a couple years older than I, so our families have been together for 50 years probably. This neighbor and their family was the backbone of a little Middle Baptist church, a little tiny, tiny country church out in the middle of the country in Middle Township there. Outdoor bathroom, they even have bathrooms. I mean, that kind of sets up, but it's a small, small church. But their family has always been the backbone of that church and it's kept it going. So at this wake, there was a large crowd. And it took a long time to get through the line, about an hour and a half standing there, but it was just phenomenal. I had the opportunity to visit with several neighbors, friends, acquaintances that I hadn't seen for probably 40, 50 years. But the one thing we had in common, because of the fact that this individual was a Christian, the majority of people there were fellow believers. And what struck me, and what I want to share this morning, is one of the individuals that came up to me and talked to me, I hadn't seen probably for 30 years, but he was an individual that we had started a Bible study with way back when Nancy and I were first married and we first accepted the Lord. And we spent many, many years being in a Bible study with a small group of people. And the one comment that he made to me was, something changes inside when you accept the Lord. And there's a commonality amongst us all. No matter how far apart we are, how many years apart we are, maybe we don't even know each other, but when we get together as brothers and sisters in the Lord, there's something inside that connects us, isn't there? When we come together here and take our communion, there's a common union here. There's something that we're sharing in common. And I can't explain it. I guess the question I would have for you, do you feel it? If you don't feel it, I ask you this morning, have you accepted the Lord into your heart? And if not, today's the day to do it. So this morning, as we take these emblems, we're sharing something in common. We are brothers and sisters. And you know what proves that? The cross. Jesus breaking his body, sacrificing his body, and shedding his blood for us proves that he's changing us. He did something to change us. And it's that changed heart that we have that allows us this special connection. Even sitting here today, we have a special connection with one another as well with Jesus, who gave his life for us. And today, as we take these emblems, we just want to thank him for that. So let's go to prayer. Father, this morning, thank you for the sacrifice that you made, Jesus, for us. We ask that you would just cleanse our hearts now and allow us to accept that free gift that you gave for us, the shed blood of Christ and the body that was broken for us. So as we partake of these emblems, we do this in remembrance of you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray these things and do it. Amen. The emblems, we can come forward and there's some in the back. of concerns here that have been handed in. Lowen Richter has been maintained in the hospital yet. He's had a couple things happen, and part of them has gone well, and another has not so well, but he's still fighting an infection, and so we want to continue to pray for his continued healing for the family there. And Betty also shares that Mel Lloyd, had cancer surgery on the 9th of February, and that all went well. But then this past Monday, he was admitted to the hospital with symptoms of a slight stroke. So he did come home on Friday afternoon, and he's going to have in-home therapy. So we just continue to pray for Mel and his well-being. So there are no other concerns. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, this morning, we just want to lift up these two health needs, Lord. We just pray for our brother Lloyd. And just ask that you continue to just strengthen his body. Just pray that you strengthen his mind and just guide and direct those that are healthcare workers in helping him, Lord. And just give him a renewed strength and comfort. And Father, too, we want to pray for Brother Mel and his well-being as he takes part of his therapy and some things that part of his healing, just Lord, allow that to go well and be with Moni too and give her strength and encouragement also. And Lord, today now as we listen to your word that Pastor has for us, we just pray for a special anointing on that word. Allow it to touch our hearts and have relevancy and meaning to us. So, Father, as we commit this to you, this day to you, this word to you, we just pray these things and ask them in Jesus' name.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Praise Him, all creatures, hear me low. Praise Him, heavenly, heavenly Lord. Praise Father, Son, and Holy.
One of the most exciting things growing up in Florida was the times we would actually take a family vacation to northern Indiana. As you can imagine, that station wagon, remember station wagons, okay? That station wagon filled with six kids, mom and dad, and all of our luggage, literally just filled that station wagon up as we headed north on I-75 from Florida for the nearly 1,300-mile trip to South Bend, Indiana. We would travel through Georgia and Tennessee and Kentucky and all the state of Indiana to finally get to our destination. And it was a very fun time. It was a great time, well, at least for us kids, not necessarily for mom and dad. You've been there, haven't you? Are we there yet? You know what I'm saying? Guys, if you don't behave, I'm going to come back. You know where I'm talking about, the traveling along the way. But one thing that was always fun as a kid is we knew along the way there'd be different milestones. There'd be different landmarks to look forward to. We knew we were on our way when we crossed the Georgia state line, and the Georgia Welcome Station served fountain pop. All you could drink. I mean, it was wonderful. We would just fill ourselves up with that. And Dad would say, "Has everyone now gone to the bathroom?" Yes, to about 10 miles down the road. You know what I mean? That was it. We were on the way. Or as you got through Georgia and you came to Chattanooga, Tennessee. We knew we were on the way. Those milestones that let us know we were getting a little bit closer on our trip. I'd like to, if you would, I want to begin a series from now to Easter called The Journey of Faith. And you might ask, well, why, Rob, is this important? I have to admit, my heart was convicted when I went to the conference last year, when statistics were shared about the condition of the church when it comes to what they believe. George Barna research group conducted a study of beliefs of Christians that discovered in American churches. He wanted to see where people were at with a biblical worldview, the way you look at the world through doctrinal authority of Scripture. Here's what he found. He asked 8 simple questions, such as, are you saved by grace through faith? Did Jesus have a sinless life? Is there a real heaven and hell? Did our life and our world originate from a master designer? Is there an absolute right or wrong? Here are these statistics. Only 51% of the pastors' question had a biblical worldview. Barna went to the people of those congregations that did have a preacher that taught the authority of God's word, and he asked the same questions. Only 14% had biblical beliefs as truths in their lives, meaning 1 out of 7 held doctrinal, only 1 out of 7 held doctrinal authority in their life. Over 85% of those who are going to foundational principled churches where the Bible was being preached and taught, 85% did not really hold biblical values. They didn't really hang on to their church's beliefs and said that it influenced their lives. 85%. That statistic just overwhelmed me. The last couple weeks, we've been looking at a passage from Philippians that Paul pins when he says, I press on to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me, forgetting what is behind. I strain toward what is ahead, and I ask myself, what is it that the people in the church today are straining ahead toward? The Apostle Paul is referring to his very own personal faith journey in this passage. He was aligning himself with a heavenly calling. He was moving forward toward a heavenly destination in mind. And as he did, there were these milestones of faith along his way. A milestone literally means it's a roadside marker. A marker that many times would list the distance to a particular location of where you were coming from. It was fixed on the roadway, and it was positioned in such a point that it became a reference point along in the journey. So in this series, I want us to dedicate, to fix our eyes as we're on this journey of faith, as we're headed toward our goal, and I want to make reference to some of these milestone markers of faith along the way. Specifically, the things here at the Cleveland Church of Christ that we hold dear, indicators, fixed journey landmarks in our belief statement. For this series, I want to take our belief statements and I want to compile them as simplistic as possible in 5 categorical milestones. Now, I'm going to be frank with you. There's no way in every message I'm going to be able to cover everything that needs to be said about all the things we believe between now and Easter. Because I have a tendency, I don't know if you notice, I can get a little long-winded at times, okay? And some of the subject matters to which we're going to talk is a little heavy to be able to truly grasp. So I want to be careful on Sunday morning that I don't make it too doctrinally heavy. I'm reminded of a preacher that had a very, very long, boring sermon. And he knew it was long and he knew it was boring when he was shaking out the congregation and not one single one said anything to him as they walked out. He was thinking, wow, I really blew it today. But until finally, the one lady who always made a comment to him as she was passing by took his hand and gave him a firm handshake and said, oh, pastor, today your sermon reminded me of the peace and love of God. Oh, the minister was so relieved. Whew, at least somebody got it today. And he says, well, thank you for sharing that. Tell me, what do you mean when you say that? She said, well, the sweet lady replied, it reminds me of the peace of God, preacher, because it passed all understanding. And it reminds me of the love of God because it endured forever. I really hope to keep you from experiencing that throughout this series. Today I want to jump into our first milestone marker. We believe in an ultimate authority. Let's pray. Father, I ask that you will use these words that I'm going to deliver as a way of helping to clarify clearly who you are and the utmost importance of how we handle the word of God. In Jesus' name. Before we get started, I think it's fair to say that everybody in this here owns a Bible. How many would say that in your home you have several copies of a Bible at home? Go ahead and raise your hand. All right, okay. Maybe different translations as such. The fact is that most American households own at least one Bible, 93%. But even though it is on the bestseller list year after year, it is the book that is most commonly found stored on a bookshelf. There was a minister who was visiting a family, a parishioner in his congregation, and as the lady invited the minister in, she was doing all she could to try to impress him and how devoted that she was as a follower of Jesus Christ and as a member. And she kept pointing out and making reference to this huge Bible that she had on her bookshelf. And she kept making reference to it to being the Word of God and its importance. And her little son, who was there, was listening to what her mom was saying, was looking at the Bible on the shelf, looking at the preacher. And finally, after listening to this conversation and her going on and on and on about this special book on the shelf, he says, "Mom, if that's God's book, we better give it back to him because we never read it." So why is this series of messages and what we believe so important? The pollster George Gallup found in his numerous surveys that only 4 out of 10 Americans know that Jesus delivered the Sermon on the Mount. A majority of Americans cannot name the 4 Gospels of the New Testament. Only 3 in 10 teenagers know the Bible reason that Easter is celebrated. 2/3 of Americans believe that there are few, if any, absolute principles that affect human behavior. 2/3 of Americans. These beliefs are not just held by those who aren't Christians. They are even held by those who profess to be followers of Jesus Christ. Nearly half of born-again Christians deny the existence of the Holy Spirit and that Satan is even real. 1 in 5 Christians deny that Jesus actually resurrected from the dead and that he's deity. 1 in 5. You see, now more than ever, we need the milestones as markers of our faith. In this journey as we go toward the goal, fixing our eyes on Jesus, who's the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. Take your Bibles, if you will. Today's text is found in 2 Timothy. The second letter, we know Timothy. If you've been doing our Bible reading in Acts 16, we've come across this young man when Paul and Silas go to Derbe and Lystra, and they find this young man living there, and Paul decides he wants to take this young man with him on his missionary journeys. Timothy becomes his protege, his disciple, the new evangelist that he'll be in training. So we find from Acts 16 that many years later, Paul finds himself writing to his protege from Rome. Paul is under house arrest. It's recorded in the end of the book of Acts, that account. So we find in 2 Timothy chapter 3, I want you to hear these decisive, definitive words Paul wants Timothy to stay alert to. Verse 14 of the third chapter. "But as for you, continue in what you've learned and have become convicted of, because you know those from whom you've learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scripture. Timothy, remain in the things you've learned." These words speak powerfully, not just to Timothy, but to us today. Hold on to what you know. Don't get carried away by the images you see and the language that you hear and the values that are promoted by the culture around you, Timothy. Stay the course. Echoing the words of Paul in Philippians 3, press on toward the goal to win the prize that God has called you heavenward. Oh, Cleveland Church of Christ, let us learn to hold fast to the unchanging truth of God's word. Amen? 2 Timothy chapter 4. Paul continues his charge to Timothy. He talks about this perseverance, this abiding in, this camping out in the word of God. In the second verse of the fourth chapter, he says, preach the word, Timothy. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, encourage with great patience and careful instruction. Again, in the third chapter, look at verse 14. But as far as you, continue in what you've learned and what you've become convicted of, this Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for the salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Here it is. Here's what will bring you to the understanding of God's salvation plan. You see, all Scripture is God-breathed. The Bible is a collection of 66 books, 39 in the Old Testament, 27 in the New Testament. The Old Testament contains the laws of Moses, books of history, books of poetry, books of wisdom, books of prophecy. God is preparing the way for His redemption. The New Testament contains the life and ministry of Jesus Christ in the four Gospels. The story of the early church in the book of Acts, which you are now reading if you're reading, following along in the Bible plan. And then there's 20 letters written to various churches and leaders on how to practically apply this discipleship journey of faith. And then there's one book of prophecy. The Bible was written over a period of 1,600 years. It gives a consistent picture of who God is, who we are, what God wants, and what we can expect depending on the choices in our life. It reveals God's promises. It gives us specific information about our enemy, Satan, and how to overcome his influence through trust and obedience to God. The Bible reveals the story of how God has dealt with mankind, how we today can have a relationship in our times now, and it speaks to us regarding what is going to yet happen in the future. Oh, look again at verse 14. But as for you, Timothy, as for you, Cleveland Church of Christ, continue in what you've learned and what you've been convinced of in the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise unto salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. See, to do this, we must be convinced in our minds as what the reality of the Bible really is. It is the ultimate authority. All Scripture is inspired by God. That is key in a correct understanding of the Bible. The NIV translation says God breathed. The King James translation says it's inspired by God. Whatever translation you use, we see this concept of inspiration. It's a Greek compound word. Again, like last week, two words put together to bring out a specificness. Theos is the first part of the word. It means divinity, God. And the second part of the word is pneo. Pneo means a breeze, a breath. It can also mean wind. Pneo, P-N-E-O. It's where we find the word pneumonia. You see, there's this concept that Paul is wanting Timothy to understand, that the Bible, in its collection of 40 different authors from various backgrounds who lived in different countries, spoke different languages, came from different backgrounds. They were fishermen. They were other prophets. They were shepherds. There was even a tax collector in the mix. Yet behind each and every one of them was God's Spirit who inspired him, breathed to them as they wrote. The unity that's seen in the unfolding of God's story is brilliance as you see the Holy Spirit in the writers, the Word of God. We see within its pages the very breath of God, how God shaped into words through the gifts of each individual, their qualities, their backgrounds. He breathed through them in different styles, but it was God's voice. It was God's message. Inspired, breathed by God Himself. You see, God, who is the creator and the sustainer of life, clear back in Genesis, in the early account, Genesis 1:1-2, in the void, in the darkness, the very breath of God, His Spirit moved. He hovered over the waters and things changed. In Genesis 2, when God forms out of the clay, out of a mold, He forms a man out of the dust. And what does He do? He breathes into His nostrils. And He becomes a living being. The very essence of being God breathed. You see, that's an important feature you need to recognize about the Bible. You need to understand its divine origin. As it makes all the difference in the world, it makes all the difference in our worldview and how we accept the authority and the impact it has in our lives. It is the Word of the Lord. You see, Scripture effectively is not mere information. The Word of God is about the power of transformation. Let me tell you that again. Scripture effectively is not about mere information. The Word of God is the power of transformation. It means bringing sure hope for the future and a peace and an assurance of eternal life. As you see, the Bible is God's book about salvation. The Old Testament foreshadows Christ. The Gospels focuses on His ministry fulfillment, God's salvation plan in His death and resurrection. The books that follow tell us the establishment of the early church and the working out of this Christian faith as we throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles us, and we run with perseverance that race that's marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. You see, in the Bible teaches that God is the master designer of the world. He fashioned humankind in His image, male and female. He created him. The Bible teaches us that God instituted marriage as a covenant relationship between a man and a woman that might experience perfect unity with God and with each other, and from which children may be conceived and nurtured and loved. The Bible teaches us that human life is a sacred gift of God that should be protected and preserved at all costs. The Bible teaches us that even though we're created in the image of God, we have this rebellious nature, and given the choice, we'd rather do things our way than be obedient to God. The Bible teaches us that the wages of sin is death, and the alienation from God and an alienation from others. I could go on and on. You get the point? The question is, do you really, really believe the ultimate authority of Scripture? There's an amusing story told of the first Duke of Wellington, best remembered for his defeat of Napoleon at Waterloo in 1815. The story is told that an inventor in Britain came to him to try to interest him in a bulletproof waistcoat that he had made. He claimed that if the Duke would wear it, it'd be absolutely marvelous. If any man ever tried to assassinate him, it would save his life. The Iron Duke was interested in it. He had the man put the coat on. He looked at it. He examined it carefully. Then he had called for his rifle man. He asked the inventor to stand still while he gave the vest a test. The so-called inventor bolted for the other door. Because you see, when it came to the test, he really didn't believe in his product. So I wonder how firmly we believe the Scriptures as God's inspired Word, as authority and revelation of truth. We need to be grounded in the ultimate authority of life. Literally, it is the Word of God that helps us to have our rubber meet the road when it comes to our journey of faith. We need to be aware. Beware of journey of faith exits. Exit ramps that want to lead us down the path of apostasy, to abandon the very thing that we see as a genuine faith in Jesus Christ. Peter warned us. He said, be alert and sober-minded. The enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion. He's looking for someone to devour. Beware of exit ramps. Paul specifically tells Timothy about this exit ramp, also in chapter 3. But mark this, he says, there will be terrible times in the last day. This is what the Message translation says. People are going to be self-absorbed, money-hungry, self-promoting, stuck-up, profane, contemptuous on parents, crude, coarse, dog-eat-dog, unbending, slanderous, impulsively wild, savage, cynical, treacherous, ruthless, bloated windbags, addicted to lust, and allergic to God. Oh, friends, beware of the exit of subjectiveness. Watch this video.
This is a red balloon. It's true, it's red. We all know our colors. The absolute truth is that this balloon is red.
No, it's not. That's green.
What?
This right here is a green balloon.
That is the prettiest yellow balloon.
Yellow? This is red. Yeah, come over here.
No, it's green.
It's red!
Yeah, I know, it's a red balloon.
Hey, will you look at it from my point of view, please?
What?
Hey, nice blue balloon.
It's
blue.
Green!
Green? It's red.
What? Why are you saying it's red when it's blue, huh?
It's totally purple from here!
Purple? Okay, you know what? Let's just settle this once and for all, okay?
Where are you going?
Hey, what color is this balloon?
I only see in black and white.
Hey, Mark, what color?
There is no balloon.
This is ridiculous.
Hey, I know what the problem is. Look, my mom taught me that this was blue. But, you know, then she said this is red and green, yellow, you know, and on and on.
Okay, I get that your mom taught you that that was blue, but, I mean, that's not the truth.
Whoa, why are you talking bad about his mom?
Yeah.
I'm not.
Listen, I respect your mother.
Thank you.
And the way she raised you. She taught you that it was blue. Our moms taught us that it was red. That's the way it goes.
I thought you said it was green.
It is green. See, I'm smart. I went to college. And in college, I learned all these different theories about color.
Really?
And my color professors who have doctorates in color. Do you have a doctorate in color?
No.
It shows. Okay? They can't even agree on one theory of color, so you have to look at all the different theories and pick which one works best for you. And green is great for me.
That makes sense.
Thank you.
No, you can't just pick whatever color fits your life the best. Red is red.
Okay, do you know the word intolerant?
Yeah.
Because that's what you're being right now. All right, you're shoving your opinion down my throat.
Okay, it's not my opinion, it's the truth.
Hold on. All we're saying is that we need to stop arguing about trivial things. Like truth.
You know, the funny thing about truth is, it's true. Whether you believe it or not.
Chapter of that letter that Paul wrote to Timothy, beginning at verse 3. For a time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they'll gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and aside to myths. May I warn you of the exit of subjectiveness? Subjectiveness is a decision based on an individual's personal impressions. How you feel. What's your perspective and opinion? Personal viewpoints and impressions that trump facts. Back in the garden, God created this beautiful environment. Adam and Eve knew the very truth of God. And then the evil one comes on the scene. In chapter 3, did God really say you mustn't eat of the tree in the garden? Again, the Message translation, verse 4 and 6. The serpent told the woman, you won't die. God knows that the moment you eat of the tree, you'll know what's really going on. You'll be like God, knowing everything ranging from the way of good and evil. And when the woman saw the tree and it looked good for eating and realized what she could get out of it, she knew everything. She took the fruit and gave some to her husband and he ate. Oh, beware of the exit of subjectiveness. You see, decisions that are based on individual personal impressions and feelings and outcomes, because that destination, that exit, that will lead you off the journey of faith until you will realize the ultimate exposure is nakedness. Because immediately the two of them saw what was really going on, and they saw themselves naked. Not everyone's personal feelings and opinions can be true. Vulnerability and rejection is going to be the ultimate outcome in this exit, because somebody's personal biased viewpoint is going to win out above everyone else's. It always amazes me, the people who scream the loudest that there's no such thing as absolute truth. You've heard it, haven't you? They label those who hold the truth of God's word as being intolerant and bigoted and fanatical. Those very people are the very ones that dictate their assumptions and their conclusions as indisputable. Have you noticed that? There is no absolute truth except mine. All scripture is inspired by God. It's God-breathed and it's useful for teaching, for rebuking, for training in righteousness. Oh, understand, it's useful for the servant of God that they might be thoroughly equipped, everything they need for every good work. Hear me. The authority of God's word shows that God is the master designer of the world and he fashioned humankind in his image. Today's culture would have us believe that beyond being male or female, one might transgender themselves in different ways. The authority of God's word unveils the institution of marriage as a covenant between a man and a woman. Today's culture would have us believe that marriage is nothing more than two individuals, regardless of their gender, coming together for whatever purpose they have in mind. The authority of God's word would show us that human life is a sacred gift and it should be protected and preserved. Today's culture would have us believe that the significance of life is really relative to your situation. Either terminating an unwanted pregnancy or euthanasia of someone who's deemed no longer has a reasonable quality of life. The authority of God's word reveals that we have a rebellious nature. And if given the choice, we'd rather do things our way. Today's culture would have us believe that it's really all up to you. You ultimately have the ultimate choice in all things because at your heart, you are potentially good. And if you were just be freed of all the restrictions and limitations, if you would be free of judgment, you would find true satisfaction and there would be this unrestrained peace. The authority of God's word exposes sin, right and wrong. And its ultimate compensation is separation from God and death. Today's culture would have us believe that there's no such thing as sin. There is no such thing as depravity. Only poor choices. Which can lead to some bad consequences. But hey, isn't it part of being human, right? I could go on and on. But I hope you get the point. The ultimate authority of the Word of God stands in direct conflict with today's culture. So much more that I could share regarding the conflicting contrast between secular culture view and the authority that we find in God's Word. But we hold the ultimate authority. That is what we hold dear here at this church. Need to bring this message to a close because there's chili afterwards, okay? So I just ask a question as the vocalists come to the stage. The question I want to ask you is, which inspiration are you going to identify yourself with? The inspiration and the breath of that was in the culture? Everyone's whims, everyone's subjectiveness? Paul puts it this way in Ephesians, follow the ways of the world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit of that who is now work in the spirit of disobedience, gratifying the cravings of the flesh, following its desires and its thoughts. Whose breath wind? Whose spirit do you want to entrust your destiny and eternity? Here at the Cleveland Church of Christ, we hold the Bible as the ultimate authority. It is the very breath of God. Because culture shifting sands of words can never bring about the hope and the peace you could find here. Because, as Paul says in Ephesians, of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even while we were dead in the transgressions of our sins. It is by grace you and I have been saved. But in the message is a very simple song. Maybe you learned it when you were in Sunday school. The B-I-B-L-E, yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. Will you stand with me on the Word of God? Let's stand.
To receive the food.
please pick up a scripture card. They're out there by the banner. We're going to encourage you as a congregation to learn this passage together. And as we close out our service in the midst of our benediction, I'd like to do it in a responsive reading. If you would read the bold part, and I'll read the italic part as we prepare for our closing prayer. Since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses,
let us throw off everything that hinders
and that sin that so easily entangles, and
let us run with perseverance
the race that's marked out for us,
fixing our eyes on Jesus,
the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. Father God, thank you. Thank you that you have shown us how we can definitely find our feet solidly on the journey of faith. Thank you for your word. Help us, Father, to embrace it with the authority to which it stands. Help us to relish in it and find the very strength of transformation from your breath that the Holy Spirit intends. And as we leave this place, Father, we pray you will empower us to be your ambassadors as we show others how to run this race, this journey of faith toward a heavenly goal. Father, as we also dismiss, we want to pray for this time of fellowship that will take place. We pray that you will nourish our bodies and there won't be too much heartburn in the midst of this chili, Lord. We ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and all God's people said,
amen.
We're going to close out our service with the words, "We believe." Sing it out with me.